Thank you for being part of the Oakwood Free Will Baptist Church Ministries. Our prayer is that those who listen to the Word of God will find a greater revelation of God's purpose in their lives. For additional resources, please visit us on the web at www.oakwoodfwb.com. Today, may you be encouraged, strengthened, and refreshed by our message.
Forward to Brother Reed coming and preaching to us, and we're going to try to give him as much time as possible tonight. I want him to be able to freely preach the Word of God, and I want to give him plenty of time for that. And I appreciate Brother Reed being willing to come and preach for us tonight. Brother Reed Wilkerson is the pastor at Hendersonville Free Will Baptist Church, and just started there just recently, right, Brother Reed?
December.
Started the pastorate there at Hendersonville. And many of you knew Brother Eddie Hodges, who was there before. And so the church called Brother Reed to come and pastor the church there. And I've heard a lot of good things about him. And he may be able to share a little more about that later as far as what God is doing there in Hendersonville. But so glad that he was able to come and be with us tonight. And, you know, Reed and I don't know one another that well. He's a good Southern boy, I know that. And we actually went with Dr. Pinson from the college one day and had lunch together. And it was a couple other fellas that went too. And so we're able to talk a little bit then. But the most that I know about him comes from Megan. And she thinks very highly of him. She's behind you there, brother. Brother Reed just finished his education at Wells College and graduated when? Last semester or?
Last May.
Graduated last May. And felt the call of God on his life, and so he went back to college and studied ministry there and graduated from Wells College, and got a wonderful family. Was able to hear his daughter in competition the other day, and some of you younger people who were in competition, she's the one, 11 years old, and playing the violin, if y'all remember her. Very, very accomplished at that. She plays the piano and a couple other things. But I tell you what, I'm so glad that Brother Reed's able to be with us tonight. And listen, you listen to him as he preaches the Word of God, and then you obey what the Word of God says tonight. So Brother Reed, you come preach for us.
Thank you, brother. God bless you.
Well, I'm thankful for the invite. Like your pastor said, I've not had the privilege to spend a lot of time with him, but I can tell you this. He comes with high regards from his peers, fellow pastors around. I knew of him before I met him, and brother, you are held in high esteem. His daughter, I heard she has recently been married. I was hoping to get to meet your husband tonight, and so I could warn him about a few things. It's too late now anyway, amen. So, I do hope you'll be in prayer for the Hendersonville Free Will Baptist Church. We're a fairly small church, and we'll soon be going through some growing pains. I know your pastor was telling me about the big crowd you had on Easter a couple of weeks ago, and Easter's always a big Sunday. We had two empty parking spots left. And so it won't be long till we'll have to make some decisions ourselves on some expansion. And those come with a lot of questions and often some pain, but keep us in your prayers that the Lord will bless that ministry there, and that he would use me, and I would allow him to use me as he wills. If you have your Bibles tonight, you can be turning to Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 36, we'll be there in just a moment. As you're turning there this evening, I want to pose a question to you, and it's simply this. What does God desire for your life? What is it that God wants for your life this evening? Now, as we think about this, I don't think it's God's greatest desire for your life that you be informed. And what I mean by that, I don't think it's his greatest desire for you to fill your head full of all kinds of biblical truth from the Word of God. Now, don't check out on me. I think that's important. The Bible does tell us that we're to study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So it's important that we spend time in His Word on a daily basis, and that we meditate on it, and that we study it. But I don't think that's His greatest desire for your life. I also don't think it's His greatest desire that you be conformed. That is, that you be conformed to a prescribed system of behavior or religious practices. Now, there are some things that we know as Christians that we're to adhere to. The Bible tells us that we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. And I'm thankful that tonight, on a Monday night, when there's so many other things you could be doing, you put a priority on being in the house of the Lord. Amen. But I don't think that's His greatest desire for you. I don't think it's that you be informed or that you be conformed to a prescribed system of religious practice. No, I believe tonight that God's greatest desire for you and for me is that we be transformed.
Amen. Amen.
That you be transformed. Romans 12:2 tells us, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." So God's desire for your life, God's desire for my life, is that we be transformed.
Amen.
It's the word metamorpho. We get our English word metamorphosis from this word. Now you all know what metamorphosis is. It's to change in one's form. It's what a caterpillar does when he enters into the cocoon. And then after a period of time, when he exits that cocoon, he's no longer a caterpillar. But he's now a beautiful butterfly. He's not what he was. He has been transformed. He has been metamorphosized. He's no longer what he was. He's a new creation. And God's desire for you and God's desire for me is that we not remain who we were,
yes,
but that we be transformed into a new creation, into the image of His Son, Jesus Christ.
Right.
We're to put off the old man, and we're to put on the new man. Well, if you find Ezekiel 36, I want to read beginning in verse 25 this evening. And I hope you'll follow along as we read just three short verses. Ezekiel 36 and verse 25, God's word says, "Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them." Let's pray this evening. Our Heavenly Father, I do thank you for the opportunity to gather and to once again open the Word of Life. And Lord, my prayer, my desire this evening is that we will allow you to do a work in our lives. Lord, that your Word would accomplish its purpose in our lives, and that we would not hinder the Spirit from working. Lord, help us to take heed to your Word. Lord, and if you speak to our hearts, Lord, that we will take it to heart and we'll apply it. That we won't just be hearers of the word, but we'll be doers. And that when we all leave here tonight, we'll be able to say that it was good and that we were glad to be in the house of the Lord. Lord, it's in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
This evening, I want to talk to you about a spiritual transformation. I want to talk to you about living a transformed life. And as we focus in on that subject, the first thing I want us to see and I want us to really get a hold of tonight is that spiritual transformation is essential to your life. Spiritual transformation, it's essential, it's not optional to the person of God. In our text this evening, it said, "Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness and from all your idols, will I cleanse you. And a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them." Those statements, those are not optional statements. He didn't say, "I might do this, and you should do this." He said, "I will, and you shall." Those are not conditional. And when we think about the transformation of our heart, for the child of God, it is not a conditional thing. When me and my family spent some time in Pensacola shortly after I answered the call to preach. And when I was down there, I had the privilege of meeting a pastor who pastored in the Dallas, Texas area. And he was telling me about a member of his congregation who was a cardiologist. And he said that cardiologist would use his profession as an opportunity to tell people about Christ, as an opportunity to witness for the Lord. And here's what he would do. When he had a patient that was going to have to undergo surgery because of the condition of their heart, what he would do is before they carried the patient back and put them to sleep and began the procedure, he would meet with the patient and their family to talk to them, to tell them a little bit about what to expect. And here's what he would say. He would look at the patient in the eye, and he would tell that patient, he said, "I want you to know that when I carry you back, I'm going to do everything I can to make sure that this surgery is successful and that you come out of it alive. But if something goes wrong and you die on that table, I want to tell you about the only one who can help you at that point." And then he would go on to share Christ. Now, I don't know about you, but that would get my attention. If I'm fixing to go have my body cut open and my heart laid to bare, and the doctor who's performing the surgery walks up to me and he says, "You know, I'm going to do my best, but if my best isn't good enough, woo! Well, let me tell you about an even better plan." Yeah. That would get my attention. But this doctor, his business is the heart business. He examines people's heart, and if the blood isn't flowing just the way it should, and if there's a cause of concern there, he may prescribe a change of lifestyle, maybe a change of diet and some exercise. If things are a little more serious, he may prescribe some medication to help take care of the problem. And in the worst circumstances, he may surgery may be required, open heart surgery. But the reason he does this is because he realizes as the heart goes, so goes the body. As the heart goes, so goes the entire body. And the Bible tells us that each of us has a spiritual heart. We have a spiritual heart, your spiritual heart. And it's the center of who you really are. Your thoughts, your will, your emotion, everything significant about who you are and about your life flows from the heart. By the way, that's the reason Proverbs tells us that we are to keep thy heart with all diligence. Why? For out of it are the issues of life. And so every important decision you make passes through the heart. The decision whether or not you are to obey the word of God, the commands of the Lord, or whether or not you're going to rebel against him, well, that comes from the heart. It comes from the heart. When I hit my mid-40s, Janice started making me go to the doctor and get a yearly physical. Now, I put that off as long as I could, but if any of you have met my wife, she's not one to be argued with. And so I gave in, and so I go, and I get a checkup on a regular basis now. But here's what I do. When I know it's getting time for my doctor's appointment, and I know the time is drawing near, what I'll do is I'll start behaving a little better. I'll start to eat better. Instead of getting a triple cheeseburger with the grease running out on the plate and an order of fries, I'll order a salad. And I'll start to exercise a little bit and try to lose a little weight. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to fool that doctor into thinking I'm doing better than I really am. I'm trying to get my triglyceride levels down a little bit and my cholesterol down a little bit so he'll give me a good report, because I know the day of reckoning is coming. And when I say that, you need to understand, my family physician and my wife are dear friends. And he will tell on me. I go to the doctor. I get a checkup. I drive back to the house. I walk in the front door. My wife says, "Well, what did the doctor say?" I said, "Well, he said everything's fine, honey." "That's not what he told me." "What do you mean that's not what he told you?" "He called me before you ever even had your car in reverse pulling out of the parking spot." And she's telling the truth. He does. He doesn't care anything about all that HIPAA code and that legal stuff. He tells on me. And so I try to pull the wool over his eyes, because I know there's a day of reckoning coming. Well, here's the thing. We all have a day of reckoning that's coming. We all have a day of judgment when our heart is going to be examined by the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, "For we must all," that's you, that's me, "we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or whether it be bad." You and I, we're going to have our hearts examined one day. We're going to have our hearts examined on that great judgment day, and the results are going to affect you for all eternity. But in truth, you don't have to wait until you die, until the judgment day, to have your heart examined. The truth is that God is examining your heart right now. He's looking into your heart right now. Hebrews chapter 4, God says something that you may have never noticed before. In Hebrews 4 and verse 13, it says this: neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto his eye, and unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Now that phrase, naked and open, it's a very interesting phrase. And here's what it refers to. It refers to a prisoner who is on his way to be executed. You see, in biblical times, they would take a prisoner who was going to be led out to execution, and they would strip him of his clothes. And then after they had him stripped down, they would take a dagger, and they would strap that dagger right up under his chin. And they would affix it there so that it would not move. Now here's the purpose of the dagger. It was not to prevent him from escaping. The dagger was put there so that he would have to hold his head up high, so that he could not hide from his guilt and from his shame as he marched down the streets and with the people on the side looking at him. He would have to hold his head up and face his accusations. He couldn't hide from his guilt. He couldn't bow his head in shame. It was open for everyone to see. Well, the Bible says your heart cannot be hidden from God. It's up. It's open before God. And right now, at this very moment, as you're sitting in these pews, He's evaluating your heart. He's evaluating the condition of your heart. Is it right with Him? Is it transformed? Is it renewed? You see, I might be able to fool Dr. Brown. I may be able to put on a good show before going to my examination and get away with my lifestyle. But I'm not going to fool God. I'm not going to fool God. He's examining me. He's looking at me right now. And one day, I'm going to give a final account. And so will you. One day, you'll give a final and a complete account of your heart before Him. And that's why it is essential. It is essential that your heart be transformed. It's not optional. It's not optional come judgment day. But not only is the transformation of our heart essential, but it's also desirable. It's also desirable. John 10:10 is a very well-known and often memorized, often quoted verse of Scripture. The last part of the verse says this: I am come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. But in the whole verse, Jesus says this: the thief. Now, who's the thief? That's Satan. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. What a contrast. What a contrast between what Satan wants for your life and what Jesus Christ wants for your life. They have entirely different plans for you. Satan, by the way, hates you. He hates you. He has a terrible plan for your life. He wants to steal your peace, your joy, your contentment. He wants to kill every good relationship in your life through unforgiveness. He wants to destroy your faith in God and God's people. God's wisdom, God's goodness for your life. That's His plan. It always has been, it always will be. But the good news is, you don't have to follow that plan.
That's right.
You don't have to be a victim of Satan's plan, because Jesus has a great plan for you. He's got a great plan for your life. He says that you can have life, and not only can you have life, but you can have it more abundantly. You can experience overflowing peace. You can experience peace in spite of your circumstances. Joy in abundance. You can experience grace towards other people in spite of what they do. You can have confidence even when your future is uncertain, because our confidence is in God. That's His plan for your life. For you to have life and for you to have it more abundantly. And by the way, that's not just talking about a future in heaven. That's talking about the here and now. You can have it, and you can have it starting today. C.S. Lewis, a very well-known Christian author, in one of his writings wrote about going into a shed one day. And in the darkness of the shed, there was a small window, and there was a beam of light coming in through that window. And as he looked at that beam of light, he started to notice the dust dancing around. You've all seen it. How it dances around in the beam of light. And he just sort of focused in on that band of light coming through the shed. He said, and then he walked over and he began to trace that beam of light back 93 million miles, all the way back to the sun. And he used that as an analogy of eternity. And he said, eternity, the abundant life, it's not just something that's way out there, 93 million miles away. He said, but it's right here, right in front of you. It's in the here and the now. It's a continuum that begins the day you get saved. And it's right here and right now, but then it traces on and on and on, all the way out, 93 million miles and beyond, forever and ever and ever. That's the abundant life. The transformation of our heart is not only essential, it's very desirable. It's very desirable because it leads to God's blessings. It leads to life and life more abundantly. But there's a third truth about a transformation, and that is that the transformation of our heart, although it's essential, although it's desirable, it must be intentional. It must be intentional. There are two things that have to happen to your heart in order to experience the kind of life that Jesus has planned for you, in order to experience that abundant life that Jesus and God desire for you. And you can see that in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. First of all, your heart has to be spiritually revived. And that's something that only God can do. God is the only one who can take a heart that is spiritually dead and bring it back to life again. A heart that is dead and revive it so that it begins to pump and to flow once again. And that's what Ephesians chapter 2 is all about. Here's the condition of those who are without Christ. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin. You were dead in your trespasses and your sin. Now, Paul doesn't say that we are spiritually sick. He says that you and I, before conversion, were spiritually dead. We were without God. We were without hope in this world. And here's the scary thing. Even though you were dead, even though you were without God, without hope, and you were dead, you didn't even know it. You were still up and walking around like everything was okay. We were like spiritual zombies. Have you ever seen one of those old zombie movies? I think Walking Dead is one of the biggest hits on TV now. I have never seen it. I just know it's about dead people. Zombies. They stink. They're rotten corpses. They go about doing all kinds of evil. And that's like just like you and I were before Christ. We were spiritually dead. We were just walking around like zombies. We didn't even know it. How do you go from being a rotten, dead corpse to being alive again? How do you go from being dead and your trespasses and your sins to being alive in Christ? Only God can do that.
Amen.
Only God can do that. No one comes to God unless the Spirit draws him. By the way, that's the reason it's a dangerous thing to say no to God.
Yeah.
Because you just can't decide on your own one day that, you know what, I think today's going to be a good day to get saved. I think today is a good day to accept Christ as my Savior. It doesn't happen that way. You don't come to Him on your terms. You come to Him when His Spirit speaks to your heart and convicts you of your sin.
Amen.
He comes looking for you. The Spirit draws you. The day I got saved, August 19th, 1986, I didn't wake up that morning saying, you know what? I'm going to go to church tonight and I'm going to get saved Wednesday night. By the way, I hadn't been to church in years. I had no intention of going that day. No, that wasn't my plan. It was God's plan, though. I just had to heed to His plan. I had to submit to His plan. You don't make that decision in and of yourself. Even down in verses 4 and 5, it says, but God, who is rich in mercy for His great love, wherein He loved us, even when we were what? Dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. Who quickened us? God quickened us. By grace you are saved. So to experience the life that God has planned for you, first of all, God has to revive your dead heart, your spiritually dead heart. And then once God has revived your heart and that heart begins pumping and giving life, you're responsible. You're responsible for developing it and maintaining it. That's what we call sanctification.
Yeah.
Sanctification is the process by which me and you, you and I, through the working of God, become more and more like Christ.
Right.
We become more like Him in every part of our life. It's a partnership. It's a partnership. You and I can do nothing to revive our heart. That's God. All we do is confess, repent, and accept. He does the work. He makes you alive. He saves you. He cleanses you. But we can do a lot with the help of God to keep that heart spiritually healthy once He gives it life. Oswald Chambers explains it this way. He says, the question of forming habits on the basis of the grace of God is a very vital one. To ignore it is to fall into the snare of the Pharisee. If we refuse to practice, it's not God's grace that fails when crisis comes into our life, but it's our own nature. God cannot help us if our nature is our enemy and not our ally. God regenerates us, but He will not make us walk according to His will. By the way, we're free will Baptists. We believe you have a free will before salvation and after salvation. He's not going to force you to live a godly life. He's not going to force you to walk in accordance with His will. That's a choice you have to make. That's a choice you have to make. God regenerates you, but He will not make you walk in His will. Spiritual transformation is a partnership between you and God, where He supplies the grace, where He supplies the power. But you have to supply some effort. You have to supply some effort. Peter explains it in 2 Peter chapter 1. It says, beginning in verse 2, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as His divine power hath given unto us. Now listen what God has given unto us. This is what God gives to you. God has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. The moment you accept Christ as your Savior, the moment you repent of your sins and ask Him to forgive you and to save you, God gives you everything you need to live out your Christian life. He gives it to you. According as His divine power hath given unto us all things, the verse says, all things that pertain unto life and godliness. That means you have that right now if you're a Christian. Amen. You have that right now. Everything you need to live godly before Him. But now look at verse 5. That's what God gave you. But now look at verse 5. 2 Peter 1, 5, it says, and besides this, besides what? Besides all the things that God gave to you, besides the power He has given you to live godly before Him, besides this, give all diligence, add to your faith. This is what you have to do. This is what you add to your faith. You add to your faith virtue. And you add to virtue knowledge. And you add to knowledge temperance. And to temperance patience. And to patience godliness. And to godliness brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me say it again. This thing of spiritual transformation, it's a partnership. It's a partnership between you and God, where God supplies the grace and the power. But you have to decide in your life that you're going to supply the effort and the will to add to that. to live godly, to live according to His word, to live according to His command. That you're going to stand and take a stand when the world around you does not. Whether that be in school, or whether that be on the job, or whether that be in the marketplace, you're not going to bow down to the ungodly influences around you, but you're going to stand firm on your faith before Jesus Christ. Why? Because God is examining your heart. It's open and it's bare before Him. So here's the question. Has your heart and your life been transformed? Has your heart and your life been transformed? Have you made that personal and that intentional choice for your life that you're going to live for Him no matter what anybody else does? You're going to stand firm on your faith because that's only a choice you can make. And by the way, before you can stand firm on your faith, you have to possess faith. Has there ever been a time when you were transformed from the old man to the new? Has there been a time in your life when you repented of your sins and you asked Jesus Christ to forgive you and to save you? Are you enjoying the benefits of a transformed heart today? Are you enjoying the abundant life that God promises to His believers who live godly before Him? And if not, why not? If not, why not? Why not today? Why not today? As you stand to your feet for the invitation. The invitation is simply this evening. If the Lord has spoken to you about anything in your life, if the Lord has spoken to your heart, if God's word has touched you and put its hand on your heart tonight and revealed some things in your life, and said, you know what? There's some things that you need to change. Why not deal with that this evening? Why not deal with that this evening? Why not obey Him? Whatever He has laid on your heart as the piano begins to play.